Mohs micrographic surgery is actually named after the person who invented it. And I always get the question, well, what does it stand for? And what is it an acronym for? And it's not. It's named after Dr. Fred Mohs, who pioneered this technique in the 1940s. And so what the procedure is like is an individual comes in to see me for a skin cancer somewhere on the head and neck. I anesthetize the patient. I remove what I can see with my eyes. So only the visible spot of the biopsy or the skin cancer gets removed. I don't take any margin around there. And the reason I don't have to take a margin is because in 20 minutes, I'm looking under the microscope at your tissue. And so you go from walking into my office, typically about 30 minutes later, I'm looking under the microscope at your skin, and I can see every single root and trace. And if there is any part of that skin cancer that has spread beyond what I have taken, I'll see that under the microscope. And the benefit to the patient is that not only am I the surgeon, I'm also the pathologist. So you have that continuity where I make a map and I know exactly where that cancer is. So once I look under the microscope and I see one portion of tumor there, then I go back to the patient and I take a little bit more, but only where I have to, leaving behind all of that normal skin, which when we're talking about the tip of the nose, that's crucial. A millimeter or two here and there is very important, whereas on the arm or the leg, maybe it's not as necessary. It's sort of that old real estate adage, location, location, location. And so when you're talking about the prime real estate locations, this is the procedure you want. And so the patient and I go back and forth and back and forth, hopefully not too many times, until I achieve under the microscope what I'm looking for, which is clear margins. Once I've determined the margins are clear, then I return to the patient. We examine the surgical defect together, and then we decide what's the best course of action. And usually it ends up being stitches in my office, usually a straightforward reconstruction. Other times we have to get a little bit more creative in terms of closing that hole, but it typically involves some kind of stitch work that we do right then and there in the office after the cancer's been removed. And then I usually will see the patient back about a week or so after the surgery to remove the stitches. Once you've had a skin cancer, research statistics have shown that you are at higher risk for the development of more, not necessarily at that same place, because once you've had the surgery, your cure rates are about 99%, but rather you are at higher risk for developing new spots on another ear or a cheek or a knee. And so it's very important for you to follow up with your dermatologist, whether that's me or whether that's another dermatologist that sent you to me. It's very important to keep close, regular follow-up, and usually that's at least once a year, and in some cases it's every 4 months, every 6 months, until your dermatologist or myself have put you back in a low-risk category. Most important part of what I do, and I would say my top priority, is removing cancer. It doesn't do you any good if I do a gorgeous reconstruction and you can't even see the scar. It doesn't do you any good if I leave cancer behind. So first and foremost, I'm a cancer surgeon, and my number one goal is to remove skin cancer. But a very close second, a very, very, very close second behind that is to make you look as good as I possibly can, is to make you look like you did an hour before coming in to see me when I had to make a big hole in you. And so I take that job just as seriously as I take my first job, which is to rid you of cancer. And fortunately, we have multiple different creative ways to put someone back together after we've had to make a hole for the skin cancer. We have lots of different tips, and we have lots of different tricks up our sleeve to make someone look as good as we possibly can.